Alrighty, good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to our session. It's just gone 2 o'clock, and we're about to jump in on our working from home, everything you need to know to create the ultimate work from home session. So, so glad you joined us this afternoon. Definitely let me know where you are joining from, so that'll be nice to know. You can use the chat panel for that. Before we get going, a couple of things just to mention is exactly that. Yeah, reach out to us. Say hello in the chat panel. It'll be nice to know just who is in the room. And secondly, there's also a Q&A option. So if you've got any particular questions, be sure to make use of the Q&A, and I'll definitely try and get to all the questions as we go throughout the session. You're also welcome to reach out to our team. You can see the email address on the screen. So if you've got any questions, or maybe if you want to become a host even of a session, then definitely reach out to our team. And they can get you on the right track. And then finally, there is also options to earn, right? So if you make use of the hashtag iStoreMeets, then you'll stand a chance to win some great prizes from iStores. So I don't know, put your home setup for us on Instagram or Facebook and tag us. And we'll definitely want to see what is happening on your end. Also wanted to let you know that if you stay to the end of the session, I'll be sharing a little promo code, which you can use to get some discounts on some of the products we'll be looking at during the course of our session. With that being said, I think we are ready to get going. So I see lots of people saying hello. So hello, everybody. I see we've got people from Cape Town, Swellendam, Cape Town, Johannesburg, Pretoria, Johannesburg, Hartbeespoort, Dam, all over. So welcome, everybody. My name is Marius. Let me turn on my camera as well so you can see me. There we go. Hello, everybody. My name is Marius. It's so nice to be with you this afternoon. And yeah, we're going to chat about some things to hopefully get you set up properly with your work from home solution, right? So we're gonna look at all the little bits that go into a great setup. So let me quickly tell you about what to expect maybe in terms of the agenda. So yeah, I think we'll talk about some basics when it comes to your setup, maybe just some things for your computer and how to kind of put it, where to put it. As you can see also, we'll talk about actually being on virtual calls and maybe a couple of tips and tricks just to make sure you can be as professional as possible on those calls. And finally, we'll talk about some apps, maybe a couple of things just to help you out to get the most from your solutions. I'm going to stop sharing my screen so you can see more of my solution. And then we're going to start chatting. So there we go. Let me stop sharing. Hopefully everyone is seeing me at the moment. We'll talk about also things you're seeing here. So for instance, I've got a virtual background, but it's not something necessarily that you need to do or want to do. So we'll get to those as we go throughout the session. So let me just make things a little bit smaller here so I can see all of you, and hopefully you can see me as well, right? So let's get talking. And the first thing I want to talk about is, I guess, your setup. So let's talk about some practical things you can do just to enhance your setup. I'm going to change screens here. So let me show you actually what my setup looks like. So I'm just going to quickly go and change cameras. So let's see if you can see a bit of a wider view. So you can see I've got quite a few things happening here, and we'll talk about what they are and what they do and how they work. So a couple of things for us to maybe start with is, I guess, the location. So if you're trying to get, I guess, the best work from home setup, you are going to have to think about where exactly do you position yourself. So I'm talking about which room in the house, and even if you're in a room, also maybe where to put your desk. A couple of things to consider is going to be possibly lighting and noise. So for instance, you want to make sure you are somewhere that you can be a little bit more, I guess, private. It also helps if you are able to almost shut off a little bit. So sometimes like just being able to close a door and being able to focus on your work does make a nice difference when it comes to being productive at home. But a couple of things to help you out once you've kind of found your spot in the house and you've kind of got the right room is firstly to chat about things like lighting. So as you can see here, well, you might not be able to see everything, but I've got actually quite a lot of windows here. So I have positioned myself in a way that I've got lots of natural light coming into this particular area. And this helps me a lot in terms of not having to go and purchase additional lighting or do additional things just to get my face lit up. Today, by the way, I don't know if anyone of you are also seeing there's a bit of a cloud buildup outside. So it is actually starting to get a bit dark. So that is something to consider as well in terms of if you have lots of thunderstorms, right? And you got like a very dark cloud coming overhead. But one of the things to consider is definitely trying to find maybe a good window that you can sit in front of. And this is going to be great for you, again, for that natural light. What we'll talk about in a second is also what are the options when it comes to artificial light. So if you feel you need a bit more light to kind of really get it going, then definitely we will also cover that. Another thing to talk about is maybe just practically looking at the height of your setup, right? So as you can see, I've raised my Mac off of the desk a little bit. So I've got a slightly higher working solution here. And this is great for a couple of reasons. So one of them being, and just for me, a practical thing is going to be posture. So because my Mac is slightly higher, it means I will literally sit up a little bit more upright. And that is going to give me, I guess, after a long day, a little less of a hassle when it comes to maybe feeling my back if I've been sitting the whole day. So a practical thing, just having a higher workstation does help you with your posture. But the other thing it does also is it raises your Mac's camera. So let me go back to the other view so you can see again what that would look like. So switching to my front camera. Yeah, this one is actually not on the Mac directly. It's just behind the Mac. And we'll talk about some of those options in a bit. But having a higher level of a camera on your Mac will mean that that camera is going to be more eye level. And this is more natural, right? So if someone is in a meeting with you or maybe a whole bunch of people, look, coming across professional is something that is quite important. I would imagine you agree with me. And having someone look up at you from the bottom, for instance, maybe not a most flattering angle. So definitely raise up your Mac. And there's a few different ways you can do it. So I guess on a basic level, you might just want to have a couple of books, right? If you've got some boxes lying around or anything that's going to add some height, then definitely that is going to be something that will just help you out. What I'm using here is a couple of products. Let me tell you about them. So this one here is called the Griffin Elevator. So a nice one because it gives you some space below as well, right? So for things like my keyboard, I've got some cables happening over here and it does kind of raise it to a very nice height and it does help a lot. So this one is the Griffin Elevator. There's another one I want to show you and this one's pretty cool. So this one is called the Moft. And the model is actually the Moft Z, right? So you'll say, okay, well, it doesn't look like much, right? I've got this flat thing in front of me. But let me show you how this works and a few things that you can do to kind of really get that height you want. So for instance, let me put it down here and check it out. So the first thing I can do is I can actually just simply raise it up, right, on the back here. And it's got like a little flap that comes out. So that's going to allow me to have that kind of a slanted option. So my Mac will sit right over here. And obviously the screen will be over here. It's going to be a little bit higher. So you get like option number one. What you can do if you want to take it even a step further, right? What you can do is you can actually then go and say, let's open this up even more. So check this out. I'm going to go and open this up. Flip out this little guy over here. And you can see it's kind of already becoming a bit more of a like a tower, right? So I flip out this guy over here as well. And I do that. And as you can see, now it's actually become quite high. This is going to be great, especially for some of you that like to also stand while you're working. It's nice also change, right? So sitting down, again, we spoke about posture. And you know what they recommend is actually that standing is actually one of the best things to do when it comes to maybe sitting down the whole day, as we know, potentially not so great for your health. So having a standing desk, you can use this guy like this. And then obviously once you're done, you can just fold it down. And you might have to read the instructions to be able to fold it like that. It does take a couple of attempts to kind of get it to do that. But the Griffin is a great one. This Moft is a great one. And like I said, even just a couple of books or maybe some boxes will do the trick as well. I guess while you're raising things up, the other thing you might consider is also maybe if you want to go with an external keyboard and a mouse. Obviously, as I'm raising my Mac up to be a little bit higher, it does make it slightly uncomfortable to type and to work all the way on top there. So you can obviously any, if you've got a Mac, you can use any USB keyboard or mouse. They'll work just fine. But obviously Apple also makes external ones and these are Bluetooth and they're wireless and they can definitely also help you out. Quickly wanted to show you one or two more things on my setup here before we talk about things like maybe lighting and audio for your video streams. So what else are you seeing here? I want to show you this little guy here. So this is a hyperdrive, and this allows you to connect a whole bunch of things into your Mac. So I plug this into my Thunderbolt ports on the side over here, and essentially I can then plug in all these little goodies, like my my external phone here for my camera. I've got my microphone plugged in there, and it really was nice about this. And what I kind of enjoy the most is, especially if you've got a lot of things plugged in, once you want to maybe just get up and go, you don't have to go and find and plug in all those things and plug them out and always kind of have a hassle to reconnect everything. So essentially I can take out one connection and all those things stay plugged in to that hyperdrive, which allows me to kind of just come back to my desk, plug in that single connection, and I'm back on the go. By the way, that also works with iPads. So I think I would really imagine a lot of you also use iPad for your work from home solutions. So you get something similar. So this will go into the back of the iPad and then allow you to also get some extra ports, including things like another lightning port, you know, some USBs and SD cards, et cetera, audio, and even an HDMI, right? So a couple of great things. Just wanted to also mention what else you see here before we move on is something over here, which you can see is a little charging dock. So this allows me to charge my phone. I've got my AirPods charging over there. I've got my Apple Watch charging as well. And I guess it's one of those things. You don't want to find yourself running out of battery or you know, trying to scramble to get things charged. So I do like the option of having like an all-in-one little place where you can charge everything here. So this one here, particular one, is the Belkin option, by the way. So it's the Belkin Charge or the Boost 3-in-1. And then also a little bit later, I'll show you what these little things are. So you can see them on the side of my screen here, right? So you're thinking, okay, what are these little things on the side of my screen? I'll show you a little bit later exactly how they work when we talk about using an iPad as well as an additional display. But just so you know, they are called Mounties, right? But we'll get back to them a little bit later. So let's see if there's any questions. Definitely let me know if there's anything you want to maybe just get more clarity around my setup. I'll definitely be keen to explain some of the things you can see here on the screen. So so moving along, I guess we'll start talking about joining and attending virtual meetings, right? So whenever you are in a virtual meeting, I guess you want to have your camera on, you're going to have your audio on, and you want to look your best. So I heard something the other day, which actually I quite liked. And what they said is, you know, virtual meetings in terms of having good sound and good lighting and a good video essentially is a little bit like your new suit and tie. So, you know, back in the day, potentially you would dress up nicely, I guess, for going to a meeting. You want to impress. You might feel nice and confident also if you have a good outfit that you feel really confident in. So so these days it's kind of changed, right? So you're sitting on the other side of the world potentially, but having a good quality video feed in terms of coming across very clearly, your audio being nice and sharp, you know, essentially those are the new things like the suit and tie would have been, you know, before I guess we were starting to work from home as much as we are doing at the moment. So so what are some of the things we can do to improve on that? What are we going to do to get our video and our audio to look better and to sound better? So let me change back to that other angle real quick so you can see me a little bit more closely. There we go. All right, so we'll talk about a couple of things. And first thing is going to be lighting. So we mentioned this early on. So getting maybe a good window is a good idea. So there's lots of natural light. But alternatively, what you can also do is you can maybe on a budget option, maybe just find a light in your house. So this could be any desk lamp. That'll do. If you're going to do that, just be careful because some of them might be quite harsh. So if you, for instance, point a desk lamp right at you, it is literally going to make really harsh shadows, you know, the other side of your nose and below your eyes, etc. So if you're going to do something like that, rather try and diffuse that light a little bit. So don't get too close to like a very hot element like the light with this, but waxed paper is a good option, right? So just kind of layer that in top of the or in front of the light, and that'll give you a nice and softer kind of a look. The other thing to do is, yeah, we have these little portable options. So for instance, I'm going to turn this guy on here and you can see what that looks like. So there we go. You can see there's a little light that just came on the side. So this one here, for instance, you can see is a little guy that also works with battery. which is quite nice. So again, I see there are some clouds building up. So if the storm had to hit, for instance, there's a chance I might lose some of my kind of a main powered lighting. So this is quite nice that it's battery powered. This one particular one is the Godox, right? So it's a Godox light. It is battery powered. So you charge it via USB and then you can essentially have it on your desk just to fill in a little bit of light. So sometimes that's all you need, right? You've got a lot of light coming into the area, but sometimes just a bit of fill light. And it's almost like thinking like a photographer, right? How would you light someone for a good photograph? Kind of the same thing. Try and get some good light and also make sure there's not any harsh shadows. The other thing maybe just to mention as I'm showing this to you is also this little guy is actually mounted on a little tripod. So this particular one is a Joby little tripod. And what's really cool about them is you can literally kind of mold these little legs anywhere that you want. So for instance, if you want to mount it on something, maybe there's a side of your desk, there's somewhere that you want to kind of hook it around. You can actually kind of bend these little legs to hook around those edges. And in this case, I just want to have it stand up straight. But as you can see, this particular one, it's also got some extra little arms, right? So I can have maybe something else here. Maybe I can put my iPhone on here, plus a light, plus even a little microphone if I wanted to. So quite handy just to have that, I guess, to improve your lighting for those virtual meetings. And again, you know, just having some good looking or good quality video, it actually does give you a bit of confidence. Not arrogance, I would say, but confidence in terms of, you know, you're going to come across well and people aren't trying to literally figure out what they are seeing on their screens, right? So maybe just to switch back, there's and talking about lights and cameras. There is something maybe to mention, and this is that I'm not using my Mac's built-in camera at the moment. And let me show you, you might have seen this a little bit earlier when I had the other view there, but let me shoot back for a second. What you'll see over here, I guess I'm pointing at it, to it right now, is actually an iPhone that is mounted on a little external tripod. So this is pretty cool. What you can do is you can take an iPhone, and this is great, especially if you've got an older iPhone. So even an iPhone as far back as the iPhone 5S, if you've got an iPhone 6, maybe just lying in a drawer, an iPhone 7 or something that you're not really using any longer, what you can do is turn that into an external camera. And I can tell you the quality is actually very, very impressive. So because those external cameras on the iPhones really made to take great photos, it also is going to give you good quality when you do this. So what I've done is I've mounted this guy on a little clamp, and this is going to allow you to mount it on the tripod. The tripod I've got here is a Manfrotto, but again, you might have one already that you're using for your stills camera, and all you might need to get is a little clamp to make it work. I see someone's asking here, are the clamps on the screen very heavy? Does it pull down the screen? If you're talking about these little guys, no, they're actually extremely light. So let me show you, right? So these little guys over here, they are very light. Obviously, if you hook up the iPad, that is going to be a little more heavier. But as you can see, as I kind of just pull these little tabs and kind of get them back, it actually does connect very sturdily. So for instance, it's not going to slide down. It's not going to fall off anytime soon, but I'll show you exactly how that works in a little bit once I mount my iPad on there, right? So we're talking about video, right? So obviously you can use your Mac's camera. That's great. Having it higher is going to be, I guess, one of the first things you want to do, but if you can, I would suggest try and maybe use an external camera like maybe an iPhone, especially if you've got one lying around, to give you that better quality video. Because also what you can do is you can then move it around, right? So for instance, this angle you're seeing at the moment is a little bit from the side. So you can see there, hello, this is the widest shot. But I can also change this obviously to the one directly facing me. So let's change it here. And what I see a lot of people do is also having that little slightly off axis, right? So maybe you just move this slightly away and slightly to the side. So it's almost like someone is looking at you working on your Mac and you can see a little bit more of the setup. And it's also a little bit nicer just to kind of see a little bit more of someone versus like literally a close-up of their face. So the app that I'm using, by the way, to make that iPhone work, I'm going to show you as well in a second. So I'll mirror my screen and you can see exactly how that works. But if you're curious at the stage, the one I'm using is called Camo Studio, right? So it's an app that you can get onto the App Store. And some of them you have to pay monthly and some of them you pay once off, but they're not very expensive. And they do make a big difference. So I see someone says, do you need an iPhone for this setup? So not necessarily. We know iPhones have got great cameras. So if you have an iPhone, I just suggest you do use your iPhone. But Nirav, if you have another phone, a lot of these apps are also compatible with other devices as well. So you can definitely see what you have and then see if you can make use of that. So yeah, I guess when it comes to lighting, you know, spoke about that in terms of having some extra lights to, you know, just make sure that you can come across very clearly. Also, what the lighting is going to do, it is going to allow you to potentially, if you want to use this, have a better effect when you're doing something like a virtual backgrounds. So I think all of you have seen those options in Zoom where you can create a virtual background. You can put a picture in there. In my case, I've got a picture of one of our stores behind me. And what you'll see is hopefully you're not seeing too much artifacts there, right? When it comes when it comes to me and the background being separated. If the lighting is not too great, and if your camera is maybe not too great, you'll probably see it struggles a little bit to do a good job. So I would say, yeah, play around with virtual backgrounds, but only if you can pull it off, right? So if someone is seeing some things in the background that doesn't quite look right, and maybe it kind of comes and goes a little bit, you know, I would probably say rather not use it at all and maybe stick with just a clean background in your house. The other thing we can talk about at this stage is your audio, right? So we know that audio is actually, you know, half of the picture. So if someone can't hear you clearly, potentially you might want to look at getting a different mic. So what I've got here, for instance, is a little Shure MV5. So a little condenser mic, which you can pick up at the store as well. And what these little guys do is really they are more focused on, I guess, the area directly around you. So that's great. So possibly a little bit less chance of picking up things far away. So maybe the dogs are barking, or maybe the kids are doing something in the room next door. It is really going to be more focused in terms of picking up your voice, which is great. Again, in terms of coming across clearly. The only thing I would recommend is, as you can see, I've got mine set up quite close to my mouth. So what you want to do is try and speak into a microphone like this. If I have it to the side over here, or even down here at the bottom of my desk, or maybe I just put it over there and feel I'm going to get a better quality audio, what you might actually find is you're not going to get better audio because it's so far away. And because it's so concentrated, you are probably not going to get the best effect. So if you go for an external microphone, you want to make sure that you put it a little bit closer. So I guess that is the trade-off. So the built-in mics on your Mac, I must say, is actually pretty good. Just keeping in mind, they are trying to pick up from multiple places and not so much focused on just where your mouth might be. So having an external microphone is definitely something you can consider. And there's different ones, right? So this one here is one that plugs into USB. And, you know, you might be asking, okay, what about things like AirPods? What about things like, I don't know, over-the-ear headphones? These are definitely things you can definitely use. So, you know, I've got my AirPods here, my AirPods Pro, and I find them very useful in terms of being on a call and also giving me a little bit of freedom in terms of moving around and not having to be so focused in terms of just looking at my microphone head on. You know, can maybe quickly stand up if you want to stretch your legs, you know, that's quite cool, and still be on the call and still actually be heard quite clearly. Just be careful, I guess, if you stand up while you're on video call, just to make sure that you are properly dressed and not with your pajamas still. So with that being said, the other thing maybe just to consider with regards to AirPods is, again, great sound quality, but also keeping in mind they do work on battery. So at some stage you might want to charge them, and that's something to keep in mind. And the other thing to keep in mind is also just comfort. So personally, you know, if I'm on calls all day long, which quite often happens to be the case, I do find it's more comfortable just to not have something in my ears or on my ears, right? So for instance, I've got these guys here, which are the Beats Solo Pros, you know, and it's very nice headphones. But if you think about it, it is really obviously for listening. That's kind of the main purpose of these things. So yes, I can put them on and you know, that is actually pretty comfortable, but maybe after some hours, it'll be a little bit less comfortable. But what's more important here is my voice being heard properly and not so much what I'm hearing, because I think most of us will be pretty happy with the speakers we got on our devices. So I think those are things to consider. I see a lot of people use them, obviously, and it does work great. And it might just come down to your personal preference. But in my case, I definitely find having an external microphone like this does give me much clearer audio. And also it doesn't give me a bit of fatigue on the ears, right? So I see also someone's asking about, you know, what about Microsoft Teams? So yeah, I think a lot of these things apply to any software. So we'll look at some tips in a bit in terms of sharing and getting your keynote presentation up on the screen and maybe one or two things to do that better. But yeah, that will definitely apply. It doesn't matter if you're using Zoom or Microsoft Teams or whatever software your company or your preference is to use. Obviously, we're using Zoom at the moment, and I'll talk about some of the options there as well later. But yeah, nothing specific, I guess, in terms of tips for Teams. I think our tips will be a little more generic. So it does apply to all the different pieces of software that you might want to use. Coming back maybe just to one more thing in terms of, you know, the place that you find yourself at. Also make sure that if you are in a room that you do have a few things else in the room. And I'm talking about, I don't know, couches, curtains, furniture, just also to help absorb some of that sound. So it doesn't help you've got a really good microphone, but also you're sitting in a room that is like a little echo chamber, right? You are still probably going to not get the best sound that you were hoping for. So it does help to make sure there's maybe some curtains, some chairs, you know, some furniture just around you, because that'll also help absorb the sound and it doesn't bounce around the room too much. All right. So we've spoken about lighting, about, I guess, virtual backgrounds. I don't know if anyone of you actually use that much. You can let me know in the chat. But like I said, if you can pull it off, then by all means, find something that works. Otherwise, I'll probably go maybe not so much, right? Okay, so we've spoken about, you know, being on a virtual call and maybe just making sure that you come across nice and clearly. Your video is also nice and, you know, clear. Something else to consider there before we move along is also, and this might be something that not people, you don't think about that often when it comes to your good quality video, but it's also, it's your connection, right? So do you have a good connection to the internet? And I think most of us probably, we were forced to do this, right? In the last couple of months or even the last year, you had to almost look at, do you have a good enough solution? So just something to kind of mention there is, if you can plug in directly to your internet router, for instance, like a wired connection, that is, I think, potentially the best way to go if you can. So if you're close enough to the router and you can plug in directly, that is going to be the best solution. If you're on Wi-Fi, you know, that obviously is good enough. I'm on Wi-Fi right now. So Wi-Fi is good enough most of the time, but just be aware that Wi-Fi is quite a chatty technology. So if you have lots of devices on that same Wi-Fi network, so you've got phones, iPads, you know, all kinds of things connecting to the same Wi-Fi, that might actually degrade the signal. So even though you have a fast internet, your connection might actually start dropping frames when it comes to your video feed, right? So so having a good connection is obviously very important. And I'd actually go as far as saying having a backup solution as well. So in my case, I've actually got a couple of networks that I have available to me. So if the one had to go down, and I'll tell you, it does happen, I can switch to another one and obviously continue on my call. Yeah, I know actually if the weather's building up like it is today, I actually know that my MTN one is probably gonna at some stage maybe not be the best one to be on. So there's a couple of things that I know already in terms of how my networks works, and I can kind of work accordingly. So I guess we can move along. So let's talk about maybe a few more things when it comes to presenting, and let's make it nice and practical. I'm guessing a lot of you use Keynote. If you are in the session with a Mac, then Keynote is potentially a great piece of software that you know already, but let's show you a couple of things in terms of maybe just how to get the most from delivering your presentations. So I'm going to move along and talk about a couple of things. And let me actually just do this so I can share my screen with all of you. So let's see, I'm going to quickly just share my screen. Give me one secchi here. Just got all these Zoom little windows, which are also kind of hanging around. So there we go. Let me then go into Zoom and share my screen so you can also see what I am seeing. So almost there, everybody. Give me one more second. There we go. Okay, so sharing my screen, and let's actually put my whole desktop, excuse me, on here for you to see, right? So here you can see is my desktop. So again, I've got some chats happening here and I've got some Q&As. So let me just move them out of the way. I see actually someone's asking, am I using a green screen? I am indeed. So I guess that was something to mention, right? So if you are using a virtual background, you know, Zoom, for instance, is really good in terms of picking up where you are and where the background is and kind of making that distinction, especially if you've got to do with lighting and replacing your background with a virtual one. If you want, I guess, the best results, then having just something green behind you, in my case, a green material cloth that is hanging behind me. I might turn off my virtual background in a second and actually show you what that looks like. Then you are going to get better results when it comes to virtual backgrounds. And I must say, because we've spoken about, you know, different apps a little bit earlier, I definitely find that Zoom is doing a really awesome job with virtual backgrounds and green screen especially. I've tried it with apps like WebEx, for instance, and didn't quite get the same results. I've not tried it with Microsoft Teams, so I can't speak to that. But yeah, your mileage might vary, right? So let's quickly look at my screen. And you can see I've got a presentation on my Mac in Keynote. And what I wanted to talk about here is maybe just one or two tips when you are presenting to be a little bit more, I guess, fluid when it comes to showing your screen and what people see on their side and not having things maybe where you have to see your notes and the other slides and actually just seeing what you need to see. And this is one of the coolest things I want to show you. So in Keynote, for those of you who actually, let's try this. If you're using Keynote, by the way, can you maybe quickly raise your hand for me in Zoom? I just want to see how many of you are using Keynote as your primary presentation software. And I see a whole bunch of people actually raising their hands. So it does seem to be very popular. And that is good because it is obviously great software. But what I want to show you is hopefully you've updated your Keynote. So you've got the latest version. What you can do is you go to the play menu. And instead of just playing your slideshow, which will play it full screen, what you want to do is click on the little guy that says play slideshow in a window, right? So what this will do, it'll give you, as you can see, a little window where my presentation will actually play back. So let's just move that around. And also what you'll see on the right-hand side, I can then see my current slide and my next slide, and I can see my notes. So when I'm presenting in Zoom, for instance, I'm not going to do it like this because you can see everything I'm doing. But what I'll do is I'll stop the share and I go new share and I just choose that one little window which is actually being presented in Keynote. So that's the one with the turtle. So let me make a new share. And that means what you see is only my presentation, but it's quite nice because I can still see everything else on my screen. Because quite often I think what a lot of people do is they present in Keynote, or it could be even PowerPoint. And as soon as you start presenting, obviously the presentation software takes over your whole screen. And then you like, you've got your chat you have to put somewhere and you're kind of putting it somewhere and you want to maybe look at the participants. Maybe you got music playing, you want to control that as well. So what's quite nice about doing it this way is you can then present only that window and I can simply use this other little window that popped up and I can go to the next slide, I can go to the previous slide. I can still see everything on my screen, including my notes. But hopefully what you're seeing is only that one screen, right? So let me just change back to the complete desktop so you can see that one more time. So let me make a new share, go to my desktop, and then there we go, right? So there we go. Those are the options that you have that you can do that with. I see someone is saying, well, can you do this with Sidecar? Yes, and that's actually what we're gonna talk about in just a minute, is actually making use of Sidecar as well, because that is the other way I like to present, is making use of Sidecar. And that is if you have an iPad and potentially even if you have these little mounties, which we saw earlier, that kind of just gives you quite a nice little way to bring it all together. Okay, so let's see. I see Nigel saying only able to view presentation, you need to show the entire screen. Yeah, so I kind of just showed you the options there, Nigel. So hopefully at the moment, you are seeing my entire screen, but I just switched over to that window share. Just going to show you if you are sharing a presentation, to share that window is probably a better way of doing it versus kind of having your whole screen taken up by the share. There's one more tip here, and this is for all the Mac users, which I'm hoping and guessing most or a lot of you are, and this has got to do with maybe notifications. So if you are sharing your desktop, let's say you are sharing maybe more of your screen and not just one little window, what about those notifications that come through as you are presenting, and maybe you don't want them to kind of, you know, just be those little interrupters. So I'll show you a little trick here, which you can do on the Mac. So let's see, Nigel's saying you are still only sharing your presentation. Is that true, Nigel? Let's double check. So I am sharing my desktop share. Nigel, I'm pretty sure you should be seeing my desktop and the presentation. There's not much to see here, unfortunately, but hopefully you're seeing my background and everything else here as well. So you can only see. So let me quickly just do this thing, right? So let's open something else here. So hopefully you're seeing more of my desktop. Let's actually just stop that share and start it again. Maybe there was a little glitch there that came in. So let me start and share my desktop. And there we go. Hopefully that's better. If you're seeing everything now, then definitely let me know in the chat. Someone is saying, we are seeing your desktop. Yes. Okay. So seeing all of it. Yeah, exactly. So again, I'm just trying to show you both options here. So this is the whole desktop, but what you want to do is kind of only share that one little window when you are sharing it with your participants. So that's only the thing that they all see, but obviously you'll have the rest of the desktop still around. What I'm talking about is also doing something which is turning on Do Not Disturb really easily on your Mac. So again, you don't want those notifications to be coming in. And potentially, I don't know, people seeing what emails you're getting and maybe what messages are coming through. So there's a little shortcut that you can do to turn on and off Do Not Disturb on your Mac really easily, right? And the way you do this, if you go all the way to the right top where it has the date, and simply what you need to do is hold down the Option key on your Mac. And as I click on that little date icon, not sure if you're seeing what happens. You won't see much, but what you'll see is that look at this little crescent moon towards kind of the middle there, right? So as I click on a date and hold an option in, you can see I can turn on Do Not Disturb really easily and really quickly. So again, you know, it's kind of a small thing, but being able to quickly go and turn off your notifications, maybe you didn't expect to share your screen and you quickly had to show something, and just making sure that people are not seeing your background as well. So so cool. Let me quickly stop sharing because we want to talk about a few more things, right? So let me get back to my notes here so we can kind of get everything we need. And I'm just going to hide that for a second. There we go, right? So the other thing I guess we can talk about is exactly what someone mentioned a second ago, is what about using additional things like your iPad also to give you a good setup? So you can definitely do that. So for instance, if you have an iPad, which I'm guessing some of you might have a Mac and an iPad, then there's something great you can do, which is called Sidecar. And what Sidecar allows you to do is then essentially use your iPad as a second screen to your Mac, right? So how does this work and what does it look like? So let me actually change over to my wider view here. So let me get to my other camera. And you can see I've got a couple of things happening here, but you can see I've got my iPad over here, right? So that's just a normal iPad. Obviously it's doing iPad-like things, but if I wanted to, I could use this extra space on here, maybe for extra windows or maybe putting my chat over there. You know, I can definitely do that. So on my Mac, there's an option for me to then turn on Sidecar. And by the way, if you want this to work, just so you guys know, what you need is an iPad and a Mac that is roughly from the year 2017 and later. So we're talking like an iPad 6 and later, any of the iPad Pros will work. And then if you have a Mac as well, that is like from 2017 and newer, then definitely that is something you can do. So on my Mac, if I turn this on, let me show you. So I'm going to actually just turn that around so you can see my iPad as well. So if I turn on Sidecar over here, what you'll see on my iPad, hopefully, is there we go. You see something changed on the screen. And what's pretty cool here is I can then actually put some of my Mac windows. You can see I'm moving a window from my Mac and it kind of arrives on my iPad. So you can use it as a second display, which is pretty handy when it comes to setting up a perfect solution because you've got so many things happening, right? So you've got those chats and you've got the participants list if you're on meetings. You might have your email open, you're browsing the web, you've got some music playing, right? So all these things obviously taking up space on your desktop. So having an iPad and using that as a second display is a pretty nice way to go about it, right? So I see someone's asking, can Cyco work between a MacBook and Mac Mini? So no. So there you'll probably do something different. To be honest, you'll probably do something called screen sharing. Kunal, if that's what you want to do, you can enable something called screen sharing, which is built into the Mac Mini. And you can then use the MacBook to do that. Nicolene is asking, how do I turn on Sidecar? So Nicolene, hopefully if you've got all the things to make it work, that's potentially a good point. So let me show you exactly how to do that. So firstly, you need to make sure that they're all on the same Apple ID. So same Apple ID on your Mac, same Apple ID on your iPad. And then what you need to do on your Mac, you go into System Preferences. So you're going to find the System Preferences app. And once you got that, there is an option there, if it, your Mac supports it, called Sidecar. And essentially you can see there is my iPad display and it can say connect to, and I can simply choose my iPad. So you can do this wirelessly. So if you've got a decent Wi-Fi connection, this works really well. If you want to have an even better connection in terms of less lag, then simply what you can do is plug them in. And Nicolene, simple as that, I've now turned on Sidecar. And there we go. We are back in action, right? Using Sidecar on my Mac. So let me see if there's any other questions maybe just before we move on. I see Kulpan is asking, well, what is the option key, right? So you're saying, I talked about doing the option key to enable do not disturb on your Mac. Kulpan, it should say option on your keyboard, depending on your Mac and where you bought it. Otherwise, it might say... what is the other option? I guess it's the one between command and control. So firstly, that's where you'll find it, right? So you got spacebar, then I got command, and then I got option, right? So that's the one you're looking for. So Kulpana, hopefully that helps. I'm not sure if yours is not named. I think it might not be for whatever reason, but hopefully that's where you'll find it. Let's see. There's a couple of things coming in here. Nigel's saying, but what about real working activities like printing? Okay, Nigel, I guess we can touch on a couple of additional things like that. I'm not sure if you're talking about maybe printing solutions, Nigel, or having the right printer or which printer. That is something I can definitely mention, but I guess we'll maybe leave that for one of our Q&A afterwards. I see Nigel is on a Google Meets now. Okay, I was in a meeting with Google Meets, but no one could help me. I'm not sure, Rav, maybe just let me know exactly what you are talking about there and I can try and help you. And then maybe the final thing with regard to Sidecar is exactly what someone's saying in the chat. So can you use the Apple Pencil with Sidecar? And the question is yes, right? So you can definitely do that. I say that's probably one of the coolest things which I use. So having the Apple Pencil on Sidecar, for instance, you can then sign things. But coming back to a home working solution, you know, this is quite great in terms of being on a meeting, for instance, and using your iPad, for instance, to display, I don't know, a graph or maybe a drawing or a diagram. You can actually then use the Apple Pencil to sketch and also make sure that that gets done on your Zoom meeting as well. So that's possibly something I can show you, because I did mention there's a couple of apps that make this whole experience better, right? So one or two of the ones that we mentioned so far were, let me remind you, we spoke about Camo Studio. So this is the one that allows you to use an iPhone, for instance, an external camera. And there's a few others as well, but that's kind of the one I like. The other thing I want to kind of talk about in terms of apps is one called Reflector. I'm not sure if anyone has heard about this app here. It's called Reflector. So let me show you what this does. So I've got Reflector already installed on my Mac. You can see there is a little shortcut right on the top there, but I can then actually mirror. So this is kind of the other way around. I can actually go and say, let's mirror my iPad onto my Mac, right? So you'll see my iPad appear hopefully any second on my Mac. There we go, right? And I can have this little window. I can make it shorter or smaller. For instance, I can put my iPad over here. And for instance, again, if I'm in a meeting, so obviously you're seeing my whole screen at the moment, and hopefully this time we kind of get it right. What I can do is I can then say, okay, well, only share my, let's go with maybe the Zoom or maybe the iPad screen, and then your audience would only see that smaller screen maybe of the iPad. But what's good about doing it this way is you can then make use of all the iPad apps to also do something, for instance, on your Zoom call. And, you know, one example is literally that, being able to maybe do a dry diagram. So for instance, I can use the Apple Pencil here and go into maybe the sketchbook app. And, you know, again, I can kind of write things here and everyone on my call will then be able to see exactly what I'm doing and maybe a nice diagram. And obviously that is just gibberish, but hopefully you can do something that has actually got a lot of meaning, right? And you can definitely do it like that. So, okay, I see there are a couple of questions coming through. So what I'll do is I'll loop back to them in a little bit. So I'm almost done in terms of maybe some of the things I wanted to cover. And then I think I'll see if I can answer some of the very specific questions in there. The other thing I did want to show is maybe some of those other apps that I mentioned, which are really great in terms of giving you good productivity. So what are we talking about? I've got a couple to share. The first one is called Meter. So M-E-E-T-E-R, right? Meter. So I've got it here in my menu bar. And what this does, it actually collates all the different meetings from your calendar. So if you've got a Zoom meeting at 12, and then you've got a WebEx at, 2, and then you've got a Teams meeting a little bit later, and then you're on a Google call a little bit later, you know, all those things will be aggregated into this one single app, and it'll actually give you exactly what is coming up and also the link to join directly. Let me show you. So I go to my menu bar on the top here, and you can see I click on the Meter little icon. And essentially it says, well, there's a team meeting or two, there's a catch up with James tomorrow, there's a webinar, there's another team meeting. And as you can see, you can simply click on those little blue buttons. And this works, by the way, with Zoom, with WebEx, with GoToMeeting, pretty much with whatever virtual software you're using. And this little guy is actually free, right? So it's a nice one to go and check out on the App Store on your Mac. Go and look for the app called Meter. The other one I want to show you is right next to it. So these are the little menu bar apps. So right next to it, you can see there's a little, well, I don't know if it looks like a mirror, but it's supposed to be a mirror. So if I click on that little mirror icon, this is called Hand Mirror, and it gives you like a little preview of your video cameras. So let's say you're on a Zoom meeting or a virtual meeting, and you haven't turned your camera yet, but you just want to make sure that it looks all right, that everything is working fine. You can see actually there it shows you the green screen we were talking about earlier. So that's actually what the green screen is on my side. And you can then change cameras. So that is my iPhone camera, the one you're seeing at the moment. I can switch it over to my built-in camera. Oh, and there we go. Like it's a little bit tilted, but there I am, right? And this is quite nice in terms of just being able to quickly preview some of the things maybe in terms of your camera before you actually turn them on. All right. So with that being said, let's quickly go and finalize just the last few things in our presentation so we can start to wrap things up this afternoon. Okay. So I've got quite a lot of things happening here. So I think I need to actually also get a few things on my iPad just to help me with my window management. I guess there's a few things that should be quite obvious, but if you've got a very important meeting or a very important session that you want to run, it's probably a good idea to also close off a lot of the background tasks that's happening on your computer, on your Mac. Even giving it a good restart is not a bad idea, but especially if you're going to presenting a keynote file and you've got many keynote, documents, presentations open, it sometimes doesn't actually work so great because you have to find the right one. And then, you know, sometimes it kind of just makes it a bit messy. So I would say close things also that's going to use bandwidth. So maybe you've got another virtual software that's running in the background, or maybe even your mail, you know, just close all those things off. So your computer has literally all the resources available for your virtual meeting, and it's got all the bandwidth available for your virtual meeting. So with that being said, I think we've covered most of the things we wanted to cover. I did say initially, if you remember, let me put this on the screen so I can share this with you. I did say we got a little offer for you all, right? So if you wanted to, there we go. This is the one. Let me quickly just share this on your side as well. So that is the one, right? So you can get 10% off some of the selected accessories we've spoken about today. And if you use that little offer code there, which is called MEETS10, you can get 10% off of some of the things we've mentioned here. And this is gonna be valid, by the way, until the end of the month. So definitely go and check it out. especially if you want to, you know. And I think this is important to think about in terms of you would have spent money earlier in the year, I guess, or pre-COVID on maybe those outfits we mentioned, right? So maybe this is now what things come down to, right? You are, instead of spending money on a new tie, you might want to spend some money on some new lighting equipment, right? So can you imagine this is where we're at in the year 2021? But either way, to make it easier for you, we do have an option for you to kind of just get a little discount there. So with that being said, I think we are pretty much good to wrap up the session. So I guess anything that remains from my end, let me kind of get a little bit more head on view here. The only one thing that remains from my end is to say, yeah, thanks for joining our session. It was fun showing you a couple of things that I'm using in and around my desk just to be more productive in my home setup when I'm joining virtual calls and to kind of maybe just look the best possible way that I can. So I hope that helped in terms of seeing some of these things and maybe just gave you a bit of inspiration as well to do something on your side. I'll have a look at the chat a little bit and maybe just hang on a little bit on the Q&A, definitely to see if I can answer any of those last questions. But I guess thanks for joining. It's been nice to have everyone here. And do remember to book for other sessions. We've got all kinds of things happening that you might want to join. So definitely go and check out our website for more things to join. So I'll hang around a little bit on the chat. But for everyone else, if you want to drop off here, it was nice to have you here. We'll chat again. Cheerio.